إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد. For the next hour or so, we are going to be talking about a very important and interesting topic. A topic that, well, let me ask you, why do you think we should be studying this topic, the topic of angels? Instead of outlining for you why we should be studying this, let's see why you think we should be studying this topic about the angels. Yes. Okay, the first point, very good, is a part of our six, one of the six arkan, or one of the six pillars of our faith, right? The six pillars of our faith are what, Mubin? Okay, so there's six aspects that are mentioned in the hadith of Jibreel, that Jibreel asked the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that what is Iman? What is the meaning of Iman? So the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that you believe in Allah. إن أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر والقدر خيره وشره والبعث بعد الموت, right? Or the day of judgment also. So six aspects of our arkan, and one of them is angels. So obviously we have to know what angels are. Okay, how can anyone mention to me another reason why we should be studying angels, or what are the benefits, if you like, of studying about the belief in the angels? Yes. Okay. So basically you are increasing your knowledge of the other types of creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tayyib, that's a good point. Is it the angels help the believers? Okay, the angels, they are of those things that help or aid the believer. But there's one point that I think is more important than this though. Yes, that's one of their acts, but we're talking about why should we study the, if you like, the this aqidah or this aspect of aqidah. Obviously, the most important is what the brother mentioned. This is one of our arkan. This is one of the pillars of faith. The reason is that through studying the angels and through studying the characteristics of the angels, this increases our iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? When we realize the greatness of the angels and their beauty and how Allah created them and their number and their acts, and the responsibility that Allah has given them, then this increases our love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This increases our awe, our respect for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It increases our submission and our humility when we realize the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His creation. Okay? I think this is one of the most important reasons that we should be studying about the concept of angels. Another reason is that this aids us. The belief in angels, okay, I have to excuse my voice, I have a slight cold. This belief in angels, it aids us or it helps us in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why is that? When we truly and really believe and realize that there are angels to the right and to the left of every one of us, recording our deeds, then, you know, you will become more conscious of committing a sin. You will become more conscious of doing something that is wrong. And you will want to do more good deeds just because someone is recording your sins or your good deeds. So this will help us. The belief in the angels, it will help us in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we study this science, when we study this aspect of iman, then this will not only increase our iman of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not only increase our submission and our humility, and not only will we better realize the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but also it will help us, or it will aid us in what? In the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Exactly. So I'd like to divide my topic, well, actually following the book, I'm using a very good book by Umar Sulaiman al-Ashqar. It's called The World of the Angels, The World of the Pious Angels. Following this book, and also it's a very logical differentiation, if you like, or the logical way to talk about this topic, is that firstly, we want to talk about the characteristics of the angels. What are the characteristics that they have? In other words, their attributes. How do they look? You know, what are they created out of? How many are they? What are the characteristics then of the angels? The first or the most the most crucial thing is what they are created out of, obviously. When someone asks you about an object, the first thing that you tell him is what is its basis, what is its root, what is it created out of. So you say, we have been created from water. Mankind has been created from water. Okay? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us through the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that the angels have been created from light, from pure shining light. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, خُلِقَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ مِن نُورٍ, that the malaika have been created from light. وَقُلِقَ الْجَانُّ مِنْ مَارِجٍ مِنْ نَارٍ, and the jinns have been created from a flameless fire, a fire that does not have a smoke to it. وَقُلِقَ آدَمْ مِمَّا وُصِفَ لَكُمْ, and Adam has been created by that which has already been described to you. In other words, from clay and from water, all the descriptions that are given in the Quran. But the point is that in this hadith, which is reported in Muslim, the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ has informed us that the malaika have been created from a light. Now, where is this light from? What type of light is this? We don't know. But we do know it is a light that is a pure and a shining light. Likewise, we have to ask, when were they created? Once we know how they were created, in the sense that they are created out of light, when were they created? The Prophet Muhammad ﷺ did not tell us exactly when they were created, but we do know that they were created before the creation of Adam ﷺ. And this, everyone knows the story of the creation of Adam, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the angels to bow down or do sajda to him. So this then proves that the angels existed before the time of Adam ﷺ. Likewise, there are some narrations from Ibn Abbas that the jinns, they existed for thousands of years before Adam, and that the angels were even before the jinns. So, because Ibn Abbas stated that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the jinns to this earth. Ibn Abbas said, this isn't a hadith, this is a statement from Ibn Abbas, that he sent down angels, or he sent down jinns to this earth for many, many generations. And then after they had caused a lot of fitna, a lot of fasad, a lot of chaos, then Allah created Adam. So when the angels, they saw the effects that the jinn had done, that is why they asked Allah, how can you place on earth someone who is going to cause fasad, who is going to cause evil? Why? Because the angels had seen what the jinns had done. The point is that this means that the angels must have existed for a long time before the creation of Adam hadith salam. But when they were created, we do not know the exact time of that. Another point, or another characteristic that they have, is that the angels are very great. They are of a very great nature. They have a very strong or a powerful or huge creation. They are one of the most huge creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is reported in a number of hadith. For example, Jibreel alayhi salam, and he is one of the angels, as all of you know, that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I saw Jibreel in the form that Allah created him. The way that Allah created him, I saw him in his original form. And he was so tall that قَدْ سَدَّ الْأُفُقْ, يعني the skies were filled by his body. The skies were filled with his body. And he had 600 wings. He had 600 wings, okay, and from each wing, pearls or drops were falling down. So the point is that angel Jibreel, and he is one of the angels, it shows then that the angels are of a very great, a very majestic, a very large, huge creation. Because Jibreel alayhi salam, his body went all the way up to the sky. سَدَّ الْأُفُقِ, يعني the horizons were filled with it, if you like, if you want a translation of that, okay? Likewise, another hadith, the Prophet said, I saw him coming down from the skies, in other words, Jibreel. Okay, his body was so big, his creation was so big that it filled all that was between the heavens and the earth. And this is a hugeness or a vastness that we cannot even imagine. If you look outside, for example, and you look at the heavens and the earth, can you imagine any object that is going to fill this whole size, that between the heavens and the earth everything is filled? We cannot even imagine this great size, this huge body that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to the angels. Likewise, in another hadith, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam describes yet another angel. There are certain angels that Allah created that are carrying His throne. They carry His throne. Okay, so the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Uzina li," permission has been given to me to tell you about something. In other words, certain things the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam knew, but he couldn't tell us because it wouldn't have any benefit to us. We wouldn't benefit anything of this knowledge. But certain things the Prophet ﷺ knew and he was allowed to tell us. And this is our religion of Islam. So of those things is that the Prophet ﷺ said, it has been allowed to me, or Allah has allowed me to tell you about one of the angels of the throne. And there are many of the angels, but one, as we know there are eight angels the Quran mentions, but one of these angels, the Prophet ﷺ says, I can describe to you only one of them. What is between, the distance between the lobe of his ear and his shoulder? Look at the distance now between the lobe and the shoulder. It's like, you can say like a hand's width for us. The distance between the lobe of his ear and his shoulder is the distance of 700 years traveling. 700 years traveling. If a person were to travel, or a camel or a bird were to fly 700 years, imagine what distance you would cover. And this is just the distance between his earlobe and his shoulder. So imagine how great this angel must be, and how huge he must be. We cannot even imagine the size of this angel. We cannot even envision it. just this aspect is you know, already defies our mind or our logic. In another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, I have been allowed to inform you about one of the carriers of the throne. His legs are in the lowest earth, and upon his shoulders or upon his horns or upon his head is the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And between the mole of his ear and his shoulder blade is the distance of 700 years for a bird to travel up. Like if a bird were to go up 700 years. And how long does it take a bird for us to disappear from our sight? Within a minute, if a bird flies up and it keeps on going up, it disappears from our sight. So imagine a bird which would travel not just a minute or 10 minutes or a day or 2 days or 20 months, but 700 years. If it were to continue to travel upwards. This is the distance between the mole or the lobe of the ear and the shoulder blade. Likewise, another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says the distance between the ankle of his feet, of his foot, to the bottom of his foot, the sole of his foot, okay? Like from his ankle to the sole is even less than a hand, it's like this much. He said it's a distance of 500 years journey. So we see then that the angels have a very huge body. They are a very great, a very majestic creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have been given a certain size that we cannot even imagine. Likewise, of their characteristics is that they have wings. Now we just already mentioned one proof of this. What is one proof that we already mentioned of this? That Jibreel has 700 wings or 600 wings. Okay. In another, in a verse of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also mentions that every single angel has been given wings. Which verse is this? Who knows? Hafiz Sahib. Anyone else? There's an explicit verse in the Quran that clearly mentions every single angel has been given wings. Alhamdulillahi. فاطر السماوات والأرض جاعل الملائكة رسلا أولي أجنحة مثنى وثلاث ورباع. That Alhamdulillah is the first verse of Surah Fatir. The first verse of Surah Fatir. That Alhamdulillah, the one that has created the heavens and the earth, the one that has made the angels messengers, and he has given them wings. 2, 3, or 4. مَثْنَا وَثُلَاثَ وَرُبَعَ. And then Allah says, يَزِيدُ فِي الْخَلْقِ مَا يَشَاء. He will increase in his creation whatever he wills. In other words, he will increase the number of wings if he wishes. So for example, Jibreel has 600 wings. But every angel has at least 2 wings. Every angel has at least 2, some have 3, some have 4, some have more than this. And Jibreel, we know, he has 600 wings. Another characteristic that they have is that in general, angels are very beautiful, very handsome. And this is proven, how is this proven? Okay, the hadith of Umar ibn al-Khattab, right, that the hadith of Jibreel, the hadith of Jibreel is that a person came while we were sitting in the Prophet's masjid. The first hadith of Sahih Muslim, while we were sitting in the Prophet's masjid, a person who was wearing very white clothes and his hair was very black. But it doesn't explicitly mention that he was handsome, but you can understand from this hadith, okay? But there's an explicit verse in the Quran. Surah Yusuf, I'll give you a hint. What did the women say when they saw Yusuf? The women that, you know, had evil intentions, when they saw Yusuf, what did they say? When they were peeling off the, not potatoes, but oranges. They said, this is not a human being. When they saw Yusuf, right, they said, this is not a human being, this is an angel. In hadha illa malakun kareem. Okay? They said, this is not a human being, this is an angel. This cannot be. He is too handsome to be a human being. He must be an angel. Likewise, in what ayah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Jibreel as, عَلَّمَهُ شَدِيدُ الْقُوَى ذُو مِرَّةٍ فَاسْتَوَى. ذُو مِرَّةٍ, meaning that this is in Surah Najm, verse 5 and 6, he's describing Jibreel. ذُو مِرَّةٍ means he is very handsome, يَرْحَمُكُمُ اللَّهِ. Very handsome, very beautiful. He has a very good look to him. ذُو مِرَّةٍ فَاسْتَوَى. Okay? So this also shows you that, the angels are of a very beautiful or a very handsome creation. Likewise, when Jibreel would come to the Prophet ﷺ, the Prophet said that he comes to me in the form of Dihya al-Kalbi. And Dihya al-Kalbi was one of the Sahaba of the Prophet ﷺ, who was known for his handsomeness. Dihya was known for his perfect features and his good looks. So the Prophet ﷺ said, when Jibreel comes to me, many times he comes to me in the form of Dihya. He takes on the shape of Dihya. So again, showing you that the angels in general, they are of a very beautiful nature, of a very handsome nature. However, there is one exception to this rule. What category of angels do not fall under this? The guardians of hell. The guardians of hell, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created them in a very fearsome manner. That if you look at them, and we think Allah's refuge forever looking at these angels, even though they are very respected angels, because they are fulfilling Allah's commandments, but they are meant as a punishment for the disbelievers. These angels, everything about them, their acts, their looks, their features, everything is meant to punish the disbelievers. So therefore, these angels are the exception to the general rule. And even then, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has still, it doesn't lower their status. They are still angels. But because of the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, due to the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created them in that fashion. Likewise, another characteristic of the angels is that they are not on all of them on the same level or the same category. In other words, some angels are better than others. Okay? Some angels are better than others. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Saffat, verse 164, وَمَا مِنَّا إِلَّا لَهُ مَقَامٌ مَعْلُومٌ. There is not a single one of us except that he has a specific status, a maqam or a station that is well known. So in other words, the angels have different levels, they have different statuses. Okay? The angel Jibreel is not like the other angels. He has a certain status above the rest of the angels. Likewise, Jibreel came down to the Prophet ﷺ one day, and he said, what do you consider the people that fought in Badr amongst you? The people of Badr, what do you consider them? So the Prophet ﷺ said, the best of us. And we have to realize that every single person that witnessed Badr, he is of the people of Paradise. Every single of the 312 or the 313 or the exact number is a different opinion. The number of the Sahaba that attested Badr and they were there and present and fought at Badr, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven all of their sins. And He is of the people of Paradise. So after the 10 Mubashirin bil Jannah, the next level of the Sahaba are those that witnessed Badr. Because even the Sahaba have different ranks and levels, okay? The top 10 of them are Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, Abdurrahman ibn Auf, Al-Harith, Ubaid al-Rahman. I mean, the 10 that have been given, Zayd ibn Harith, the 10 that have been given, the Mubashirin of Jannah. They said that Allah, that the Prophet ﷺ has told them that they're going to enter Jannah. This is the highest category of the Sahaba, these 10. After this comes the level of the people who attested Badr. So the Prophet ﷺ said that we consider them to be the best of us. So Jibreel said, likewise, those angels that helped the Muslims at Badr, they are the best amongst us. So this shows you what then? That the angels also have different degrees, different levels, different ranks. All of them are of the perfect creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of them are noble, all of them are honored, just like all of the Sahaba are honored. But that doesn't mean that they are of the same level. They have different levels, they have different categories, they have different stations to them. Another characteristic of the angels, and this is something that is very important for us to believe and know. Excuse me. Is that the angels cannot be given the characteristics of being either male or female. Okay, the angels are, they don't have a gender. We don't attribute a gender to them. How do we know this? We know this because the mushrikun, they used to consider that the angels were what? That they were females, that they were daughters of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, okay? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refutes them in the Quran many times. That how can you call them women? How can you call them daughters? How can you call them females? And you have no knowledge of this. And He doesn't say that they are males. And He doesn't say that they are females. So this shows us then that the proper thing is that we don't call them males or females. We consider that they are a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they don't have a gender to them. All of them are of a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we don't consider them males or females. Okay? Unlike man and unlike jinn. Mankind is composed of male and female. Likewise, the jinn are also composed of male and female. But the angels are above this category. They don't have this categorization of male and female. Likewise, another mistake that the Christians fall into is they consider angels to be babies. Okay? Well, because that's how they you know, portray them in their portraits and everything. This too we must reject. We are not allowed to portray them as anything. We cannot obviously draw pictures of them, obviously, but even in our conceptual minds, we cannot consider them to be babies or anything like this. This is of the lies that have been invented by the disbelievers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet another characteristic of the angels is that they do not eat or drink. What is the proof for this? Who knows? All of you know these stories, you know, but you just have to understand the point of benefit from the story. The Prophet Ibrahim, a clue. What happened with him? The angels came down. What did he do to them? He offered them, he sacrificed for them a camel. He sacrificed a camel for them, or sacrificed a goat. He sacrificed something for them. And what did they do? They refused to eat from it. And this caused Ibrahim to become scared, fearful. What type of creation is this that does not eat? How is it that I present this juicy meat to them and they cannot eat of it? They refuse to eat from it. And you have to realize this was a very, they say that it is said, it is not a hadith, it is said that Ibrahim was the one who started hospitality. The concept of hospitality to the guest was started by Ibrahim when he did this. Okay, this is a sunnah that to our times we should follow it. That when a guest comes to us, we should rather go hungry and give food to the guest. You know, this is of our sunnah and of our characteristic, of the noble characteristic of our religion of Islam. And it is said that Ibrahim was the one who started this noble characteristic, this noble trait. That when the guests came, even though there were only two, he sacrificed a large amount of meat for them. And he presented it to them. He cooked it for them and he presented it to them. Okay, but they refused to eat. So when they refused to eat, he became scared, he became fearful. And then he said, don't be fearful, we are messengers from your Lord, we are angels. So the point is that they do not eat or drink, they are not in need of eating or drinking from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created them in a way that they don't need to eat or drink. Another characteristic is that they never get tired, so they are not in need of sleep or anything, they never get tired. They don't become physically tired or, you know, they need to rest or anything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes them in the Qur'an, يُسَبِّحُونَ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارَ لَا يَفْتُرُونَ Surah Anbiya verse 20. That they say tasbih subhanallah, day and night, and they never become tired. Day and night, 24 hours a day, the angels are just saying subhanallah, 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 and they never become tired. In another verse, Surah Fussilat verse 38, فَالَّذِينَ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ يُسَبِّحُونَ لَهُ بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ وَهُمْ لَا يَسْأَمُونَ As for those who are with your Lord, then they give tasbih, they say subhanallah, day and night, and they never become bored. La yas'amun, they never become bored, it doesn't become repetitive for them to say this. Okay? So another characteristic is that they don't become bored of their acts of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Where do the angels stay, or what is their residing place? In general, it is the skies. The skies above us, okay? In general, the skies, even though, of course, they come down and they are present on this earth and they're present above the skies, but in general, most of the angels are in the skies. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, تَكَادُ السَّمَاوَاتُ يَتَفَطَّرْنَ مِنْ فَوْقِهِنَّ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ يُسَبِّحُونَ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّهِمْ It is possible that the skies are about to burst on top of them, and the malaika, they give tasbih in it, in the skies. Okay? Likewise, in one hadith, the Prophet said that أَطَّتِ السَّمَاءُ وَحُقَّ لَهَا أَمْ تَقِطَّ That the earth or the skies are creaking. You know what a creaking sound is, right? They are creaking. And they have every right to creak. They have every right to emit this sound. There is not a single space of four fingers long, except that there is an angel present in it, either standing and worshipping Allah, or doing ruku' or doing sajda to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you look at the skies above us now, and the Prophet is saying there is not a single hand's width, four fingers. You're not going to find this much space in the skies, anywhere in the skies, except that there is an angel in that space, either standing up and praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or in ruku' or in sujood. So the Prophet is saying is that the sky has every right to creak. It's loaded, it's burdened with so many angels. It has so many angels in it that it has every right to emit this creaking sound from it. Okay? So the Prophet is saying is that the sky is creaking. So right now we have to believe the sky is creaking. We can't hear it. We don't know how it is creaking. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given it this characteristic. And then the Prophet gave an excuse. He said it has every right to creak. It has every right to make this sound. Because there's not a single space of four fingers long. In other words, you won't find this much space in the skies. Empty. There's no such thing as a real vacuum then, huh? We get metaphysical here. There is no length, 4 fingers long, except that there is an angel there. Except that there is an angel there worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this shows you then that the skies are the place of the angels. Likewise, another characteristic that the angels have is that they are numerous in number. We cannot say infinite in the sense there is obviously a certain, I mean Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created a certain amount of angels, but for our level, for our purposes, they might as well be infinite. There are so many, they are so numerous in quantity that we cannot envision this number. We cannot think of this number even. Okay? Forget the billions and trillions and forget the US deficit even, it's bigger than that. You know? We cannot even envision this number that the angels are. The proof for this is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا يَعْلَمُ جُنُودَ رَبِّكَ إِلَّا هُ. What surah is this in? وَمَا يَعْلَمُ جُنُودَ رَبِّكَ إِلَّا هُ. Very good, mashallah. Surah Muddathir, verse 31. That no one will be able to count the army of your Lord except Him. The army meaning the angels of Allah. No one can count their number except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So their number is so great, they are so numerous, that we cannot even count, no creation can count even their number. Forget about understanding, no one can even count it. That's how many there are. Likewise, the Prophet ﷺ said that above the Kaaba there is a house known as the Baytul Ma'mur. Okay? It is Baytul Ma'mur means the well-frequented house. Even the name shows you well-frequented house, okay? It is in the seventh heavens. And every day, 70,000 angels come to this house. Okay? Every single day, 70,000 angels come to this house. And no single angel comes again until the Day of Judgment. In other words, since the beginning of the creation of Bayt al-Ma'mur, and Allah knows how many, you know, what time or frame that was in, until the end of the angels, or until the end of time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to cause 70,000 angels, new batch, every day, to come to this Bayt al-Ma'mur, to come to this holy or this blessed house, and then these same angels that came, they are not going to come again, ever. So every day, 70,000 new angels will come, is my point. So imagine now, after 10 days you're going to have 700,000. After 100 days you have 7 million. Okay? 1,000 days you have 70 million. And it goes on like this and this and this. And this has been going on since Allah knows when and until Allah knows when. So in a very short period of time, if you keep on adding up 70,000, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created so many angels that we cannot even imagine this in our head. This number cannot even be imagined in our head. Likewise, another proof we mentioned in the last section. The number of angels. Another proof that the angels are so numerous. We just mentioned it in the last section. The skies, exactly. That there is not even a hand's width, 4 fingers length, except that there is an angel there. So look above you. And realize that wherever you see above you, there has got to be an angel standing there. So this is their number, and this is their you know, numerousness. That we cannot even imagine the amount of angels. Likewise, for example, one of the hadith that also shows their number is that the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that on the day of resurrection, on the day of Qiyamah, Jahannam is going to be dragged. In other words, Jahannam will actually be physically brought forth on the day of resurrection. It will be brought forth so that everyone can see it. And we seek Allah's refuge from ever entering or coming close to it. That Jahannam will actually be brought forth on the day of judgment, on the place of resurrection. How will it be brought forth? The Prophet ﷺ described. He said, Jahannam is going to have 70,000, what do you call those rings that you latch onto something and you can pull. So Jahannam is going to have 70,000 of those rings. And on every ring there's going to be a rope, and on that rope, every rope is going to have 70,000 angels. So what's 70 times 70? 7 times 7 is 49. 70 times 70 is... 4,900, right? Yeah, 4,900. So 70,000 times 70,000 is 4.9 million, right? 4.9 million. So just the number of angels that are meant to drag hell is going to be like 5 million. Just the number that are going to drag hell. So this shows you their numerousness or their great quantity, and this also shows you the size of hell. That we seek Allah's refuge from it. That it needs 5 million angels. And we described how big the angels are. They're not like one of us, you know. We described how big and how powerful the angels are. and these 5 million angels is going to, they're going to be dragging hell. Okay, so we seek Allah's refuge from the evil of hell. Okay, how about their names? How about the names of the angels? We do know that the angels have names, right? Well, they can be seen if they want to. We're going to get to the world. How about their names? How about the names of the angels? We do know that they have been given names, right? Okay, who can mention to me some name and the proofs for those names? We don't just want people to say this, this. We want them to quote their proofs from the Quran and Sunnah. Where did you get this name from? Okay, so who can quote me one name? Mubin. What's your proof? Very good. Where in the Quran? My proof is the Quran. Alhamdulillah, we agree with you. It's a correct answer, but it's worth 0 points. Realize there are three types of answers, by the way. There's a correct answer that is worth full points. There's a correct answer that's worth no points. And then there's an incorrect answer. So if you were to go to an exam and your teacher asks you a question and you don't know the answer, you say, Allah knows this answer. It's correct, but you're going to get 0 points for it. Okay? So it's a correct answer, but it's not worth anything. No partial credit for that. It's in the Quran. Where in the Quran? How can you say Jibreel indirectly? Well, you said the Quran. Let's be orderly now. Where in the Quran is it mentioned Jibreel's name? Hafiz Abid mentions it more than once. You should know this. No. Explicitly. Baqarah where? You have to quote the longest surah and then get us lost in it. If you quote like Surah Al-Kawthar, we say, okay, we'll look it up. You know what I'm saying? You say Baqarah, 50, 60 pages long, you say, find it in there. First juz, okay, you've narrowed it down even more. Correct, still. Okay, you said it in English. Now let's translate this to Arabic. مَنْ كَانَ عَدُوًا لِجِبْرِيلَ فَإِنَّهُ نَزَّلَهُ عَلَىٰ مَنْ كَانَ عَدُوًا لِلَّهِ وَلَىٰ No, but then after this. مَنْ كَانَ عَدُوًا لِجِبْرِيلَ Whoever is an enemy to Jibreel. Whoever is an enemy to Jibreel. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explicitly, قُلْ مَنْ كَانَ عَدُوًا لِجِبْرِيلَ Whoever, tell them Muhammad, whoever is an enemy to Jibreel, then he is the one who has revealed it to your heart with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay. Likewise, Allah, then Jibreel has been mentioned implicitly. For example, Allah calls him the Ruhul Amin, the trustworthy spirit. Nazala bihi Ruhul Amin, that the trustworthy spirit has revealed this. Likewise, Mikael has also been mentioned. Where? Huh? Jibreel wa Mikala. Also in the Quran, same verses. Jibreel wa Mikala. Okay. In the same verses, Mikala, and there are two ways of reciting Mikal, Mikal and Mikail. Okay? There are both of them have been in the Qira'at. So this, the name Michael, by the way, is based obviously on Mikail. The Christian name Michael is based on this name, Mikail, which is also pronounced in the Quran as Mikal and Mikail, both ways. But both of these names, Jibreel and Mikail or Mikal, have been mentioned explicitly in the Quran and many times in the Sunnah. Many times in the Sunnah. Hadith of Jibreel and so many other hadith. What other names have been mentioned? Harut and Marut, who says that? Okay, very good. Where? The magic. Okay, let someone quote the Arabic now. Baqarah 102. MashaAllah, you remember the verse. You actually know the verse. Harut and Marut. وما كفر سليمان ولكن الشياطين كفروا يعلمون الناس السحر وما أنزل على الملكين ببابل هاروت وماروت. Okay, verse 102 explicitly mentions two other angels' names, Harut and Marut. Yet what is yet another name of an angel? Huh? Malik. Okay. He is the angel or the guardian angel that is in charge of hell. Where does it mention this? وَنَادَوْا يَا مَالِكُ لِيَقْضِ عَلَيْنَا رَبُّكَ And they cried out, O Malik! O Malik, call on your Lord to save us from the fire of hell. So the people in hell, when they see the angel, when they see Malik, he is the guardian of hell, they're going to cry out, يَا مَالِكُ O Malik, save us, or tell, ask your Lord to save us from this fire. Or ask your Lord to remove this from us. Okay? Then Malik will respond, إِنَّكُمْ مَاكِثُونَ You are going to stay here forever. You're never going to come out. So Malik, the name Malik has also been mentioned in the Quran. Very fierce looking. Yeah. Which surah? Surah Zukhruf, verse 77. Okay, there is no more angel that is mentioned. No, there is one more angel that is mentioned in the Quran, actually. But that's not a name, that's a characteristic. Where is Israfil mentioned? Where is it mentioned? We said we want evidences. We said we want evidences. We don't just want people to know what their, you know, elders taught them when they were children. We want them to know where they got this information from. Okay? To know your evidences for your religion is very important. You know this. Israfil. Israfil is not mentioned in the Quran. Israfil is not mentioned in the Quran. He is mentioned in a number of ahadith. Amongst them is the one reported by Tirmidhi, in which the Prophet ﷺ said, Allahumma Rabba Jibreel wa Mika'il wa Israfil. O Allah, our Lord, the Rabb of Jibreel, and the Rabb of Mika'il, and the Rabb of Israfil. And then he continued the dua. Okay? Likewise, there's one hadith in which the Prophet ﷺ said, How can I be content, or how can I be peaceful? How can I find peacefulness when Israfil, when the one who has the trumpet has put the trumpet to his lips and he is looking at the throne waiting for the commandment to be given to be blown for the Day of Judgment. In other words, the Day of Judgment is so close now that Israfil has taken the horn, put it to his lips, and he is, in another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ describes him that Israfil is not even blinking out of fear that if he blinks, Allah will command him at that time. So Israfil is not even blinking. At this point, right now, we have to believe that Israfil has the trumpet connected to his mouth. He is ready to blow at any second. And he's staring in the direction of the throne. He is staring in this direction, fearful of even blinking, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might command him to blow it at any time. Okay? So the Prophet said, how can I be peaceful? How can I be content right now? How can I, you know, become involved in this dunya? When the angel of the trumpet is so close to blowing the trumpet. Okay, so again, this is the duty of Israfil. By the way, this hadith in which the Prophet ﷺ mentions Allahumma Rabba Jibreel wa Mika'il wa Israfil, the ulama say that in this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ combined the angels of life, all of the angels of life. Jibreel is the one who brings down the revelation. Okay, so he is the one who brings the spiritual life to us. Mika'il is the one who is in charge of the physical sustenance, rain and food and crops. Okay, so he is the one who is actually in charge of our physical rizq. Israfil is the one who is going to blow the trumpet when all of us will be resurrected for the Day of Judgment. So once again, bringing us back to our eternal life. Okay, our lives right now are not eternal. They are a short span, very short span. But when Israfil blows the trumpet for the second time, okay, then in this time our bodies will be resurrected once more, and so we will have a permanent life. So Israfil is the one who is in charge of, if you like, of re-resurrecting us because of the throne. So in this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ combined all of the three types of life. رَبَّ جِبْرِيلَ وَمِكَائِيلَ وَإِسْرَافِيلَ. The Lord of the angel of Jibreel, the Lord of the angel of Israfil, the Lord of the angel of Mikrail. So if Jibreel and Mikael and Israfil are so powerful, then imagine how their Lord will be. Okay? So this is why that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is being described by the Prophet ﷺ in this hadith as رَبَّ جِبْرِيلَ وَمِكَائِلَ وَإِسْرَافِيلَ. That when Jibreel is the one that brings down the life of our bodies, spirits, and Mikael is the one who brings down the life of our limbs, our food that we eat, and Israfil is the one that will give us our eternal life, then imagine how great their Lord will be. These are only angels. Okay, so this hadith has a very beautiful aspect to it. Okay, other angels that whose names have been mentioned in the Sunnah. Those are not names. Raqib and Atid. Raqib means that he is ready to take it down. Atid means he is going to write it. It's not. They're not names. They are descriptions. Ridwan. There are some narrations that mention that the angel who is in charge of the gate of paradise, his name is Ridwan. Okay. There are some narrations that Ibn Kathir mentions. I don't know the authenticity of them, and I have to go back and look them up. Nonetheless, they do exist. Some narrations do exist that mention Ridwan. Okay. There is one more angel of human that is mentioned in the Quran, Malakul Maut. The name of this angel is Malakul Maut, the angel of death. That is his name, Malakul Maut. Okay? قُلْ يَتَوَفَّاكُمْ مَلَكُ الْمَوْتِ الَّذِي وُكِّلَ بَكُمْ. Say, the angel of death is going to take your soul. And he is referred to by this name in the Quran and in the Sunnah. Malakul Maut. Malakul Maut. So one more name that is mentioned in the Quran or the Sunnah is Malakul Maut. It is a name that at the same time is an attribute or description. Okay? Because his job is the angel of death. And his name also is the angel of death. Malakul Maut. Okay. There are other names that are mentioned in the Sunnah. Come on guys, you know this. Every one of you knows this. Haris. You know this. I know every single one of you knows this. But you're just not... So you have to categorize what you learn very nicely. So that you can withdraw it at any time. You have to basically build a database, right Shafiq? So you can try to... Huh? We already mentioned Harut Marut. Azrael, okay, let's say this is one name that is mentioned, Azrael. Not Israel. Not Israel, he's not an angel, no. They don't have names. Azrael is mentioned in Islamic literature, but it is not found in any Quran, any Quranic ayah or any hadith. Therefore, we should not call any angel by this name. Is that clear? Who is Azrael that they say he is? They say that this is his name. In reality, this is not found anywhere in the Quran or Sunnah. It is found in Judeo-Christian literatures. So therefore, it entered into Islamic literature later on. But it is not found in the Quran or Sunnah. Neither did Allah nor His Messenger call the Malik al-Maut Azrael. In fact, they always call the Malik al-Maut. So we should also call the Malik al-Maut. Who are the ones that are going to test us in the grave? Ah, where did they go now, you see? Everyone knows this. Munkar and Nakir. Munkar and Nakir. That the two angels that are going to come to test every believer in the grave, they are Munkar and Nakir. Okay? These two angels don't have names. They don't have names, they have descriptions in the Quran. They don't have names. Okay? Munkar and Nakir. Munkar and Nakir is in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Huh? Munkar and Nakir are names. Munkar and Nakir are names. Okay? Okay, these are the names of the angels. Now, are the angels going to die? Never, ever, ever? Huh? When? When the trumpet is blown, that is when they are going to die. When the trumpet is blown, that is when the angels will die, and then they will be resurrected again. Okay? There are some narrations that describe this. I don't know the authenticity of these narrations. The point is, we do know that the angels in general are all going to, Also, you have to realize that the angels are of the ilmul ghayb, of the knowledge of the unseen, which means that we will never have details about the angels and their lives. All that we have is what is found in the Quran and Sunnah. We cannot, think or use our intellect or logic to talk about the angels. No. Okay? Angels are of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't think about them. We don't, Whatever is found in the Quran and Sunnah, we believe it. So anything beyond that, we stay quiet about it. Okay? Some of the aspects or some of the things that the angels are capable of, firstly, they are capable of appearing in different forms. Okay? Who can give me some examples where angels appear in human forms that are found in the Quran? Found in the Quran, firstly. Very good. The angels came to the Prophet Lut. Who else? Ibrahim. Very good. Who else? Maryam, very good. The angels came to Maryam and they announced that she is going to have Isa. Musa, where did the angel come to Musa? Huh? No, they didn't come in a human form. Nuh, when did the angels come to Nuh in a human form? Obviously they came because Jibreel came to all of the prophets, but I'm talking in human form that the people saw them. Harut and Marut, they came in human form. Battle of Badr, some of the mushrikun saw the angels, yeah. Okay, but the point is that from all of these incidents, from all of these characteristics, we come to the conclusion that angels can take on the form of humans, and they can appear in human form, and people can see them if they wish, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala desires, okay? Likewise, we gave the hadith of Jibreel, is that when Jibreel comes to the Prophet, many times he used to appear in the form of who? Dihya al-Kalbi. Okay, he would appear in the form of Dihya al-Kalbi. And we said that Dihya was a very handsome or a very good-looking companion. So Jibreel would come in his form. Likewise, in the hadith of Jibreel, the famous hadith of Jibreel, when the Prophet was sitting with the companions, and Umar ibn al-Khattab said, a man came into us wearing very white clothes and very black hair. And he had no... They saw the angel. He was in a human form. Okay? So this shows you that the angels can appear in human form. Likewise, Aisha radiallahu anha, once she was with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or she saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam coming and talking for a long time with Dihya. Or she thought it was Dihya. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam entered his house, he said, who did you see me with? She said, Dihya. Okay? And then he left to the masjid and made an announcement that Jibreel just came to me and said, and then he gave the announcement that Jibreel had just said. But basically, Aisha said, I didn't realize it was Jibreel. I thought it was Dihya. And he was talking to the Prophet for a long time. Okay. So Aisha saw her. Aisha saw him, excuse me. Aisha saw the angel Jibreel. Okay. So this shows you then that it is possible that the angels appear in forms that mankind can see if they wish. Likewise, their speed. Their speed, the angel's speed. The angels travel at extremely fast speeds if they so desire. They can travel at extremely fast speeds. Okay? And yani, we don't have to go into the metaphysics here, but the fact of the matter is that, you know, the angel Jibreel will come down and give inspire the Prophet immediately if something were to occur. Okay? For example, the famous hadith in Sahih Bukhari, in which Aisha says, excuse me, that she was sitting on one corner of the room, and a woman came to the Prophet ﷺ complaining about her husband and something that he had done. And she said that I could not hear them speaking on the other side of the room. I could just barely hear them talking. In the sense, I could hear, you know, bits and pieces of the conversation. I couldn't understand the conversation. And immediately, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I could see the Prophet ﷺ being inspired by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the point is that Aisha, and she is sitting right next to the Prophet ﷺ, a few feet away, because you know the Prophet's house was very small. She could not hear. And yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Aisha said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala above the seven heavens heard what the Prophet ﷺ said. Not only that, but Jibreel immediately came down and inspired the Prophet ﷺ with what was, or with the inspiration, which is the beginning verses of Surah Al-Mujadala. The beginning verses of Surah Al-Mujadala were revealed at this incident. قَدْ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ قَوْلَ الَّتِي تُجَادُلِكَ فِي زَوْجِهَا. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has heard the speech of the woman that came to you complaining about her husband. Okay, so Aisha, she was sitting in the same room, could not hear the Prophet ﷺ or the woman. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala above the seven heavens could hear, and immediately he sent the angel Jibreel to inspire the Prophet ﷺ. So we don't want to get too metaphysical, but the point that I want to stress here, the point I want to get across is the idea that certain modern scientists, Muslim scientists have, is that the angels are in fact only manifestations of a type of light energy. This is ridiculous. This is sheer stupidity, you know. The angels are not some type of what do you call that energy scale? That energy? Spectrum. The spectrum, the energy spectrum. The angels are not one section of the spectrum, no. You know, they are above this. They have nothing to do with this. And the point is that they go faster than what we consider to be the faster thing, the speed of light. The angels go faster than this, okay? And again, I don't want to get too metaphysical here, because this is not a science that is Islamic in the least. But the point is that the angels are an actual creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are not a perverted form of energy that is just traveling in wavelengths. No, they are an actual creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is a clear refutation of these groups of scientists, Muslim scientists, that believe that the angels are merely energy. Why? Because energy has a certain maximum speed that it can travel with, the speed of light. Okay? And we know that the angels can travel faster than the speed. So they are not of this, you know, nature that these modernists claim them to be. Likewise, of the characteristics of the angels is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them some knowledge, and He has not given them certain types of knowledge. Each angel has been given a certain type of knowledge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But they don't have the knowledge, or they don't have, excuse me, not the knowledge, they don't have the characteristics that man has to learn. They cannot learn except if Allah wills them to learn. Mankind, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him a certain thing called intellect. Okay? He can study, he can... As for the angels, they have no knowledge except what Allah has blessed them with. Like Allah says in the Quran, قَالُوا سُبْحَانَكَ لَا عِلْمَ لَنَا إِلَّا مَا عَلَّمْتَنَا. They said, سُبْحَانَكَ, we don't have any knowledge except what you have taught us. The angels said this at the creation of Adam. We don't have any knowledge except what you have taught us, O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? So the angels, they have to, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will inspire them or will teach them with the knowledge that they must know. And obviously each angel has been given the type of knowledge that he needs. Likewise, another characteristic, or the final characteristic that we will take before we move on to other aspects of the angels' existence, is that they are very organized in their fields, whatever they are doing. They are very organized, they are very orderly. The Prophet ﷺ said to the companions one day, do not wish to line up in prayer like the angels line up. They said, how do the angels line up, Ya Rasulullah? He said, the angels, they complete the first row. They complete the first row before they move on to the second one, and they يَتَرَاصَوْنَ فِي الصَّفِ. As a number of meanings, so basically, they are close together and they are packed in the صفوف. In other words, row upon row upon row. Okay? It's like, you know, like a very organized, a very orderly type of thing. Likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَجَاءَ رَبُّكَ وَالْمَلَكُ صَفًّا صَفًّا. Which surah is this in Imran? وَجَاءَ رَبُّكَ وَالْمَلَكُ صَفًّا صَفًّا. They're saying Fajr. It is in Surah Al-Fajr. وَجَاءَ رَبُّكَ وَالْمَلَكُ صَفًّا صَفًّا. Your Lord will come. When will your Lord come? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself is going to come in a matter that we don't know, we don't think about, but He will come. And He is going to judge between the creation. But Allah says, وَجَاءَ رَبُّكَ, your Lord will come, وَالْمَلَكُ, and the angels, صَفًّا صَفًّا, this is the point of the verse, row upon row. In other words, in an orderly fashion, an organized manner. Okay? وَجَاءَ رَبُّكَ الْمَلَكُ صَفًّا صَفًّا. So this shows you then that the angels have a very organized way, or very, yes. We are getting there. We're getting to the worship of the angels right now. We're getting to the worship of the angels now. Okay? Now, this was the characteristic of the angels that we had. The second chapter, the second point that we want to discuss are the worship, or how the angels worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is the characteristic of the worship of the angels? Firstly, like the brother mentioned, the most important point of this chapter, of this section, is that the angels, they simply cannot disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They just don't have the free will that mankind has to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They do not have a choice in the matter. If Allah tells them to do something, they will do it. There are no doubts, they will do it. They are pure worshippers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the sense, no evil thought will come to them. They are not going to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is the proof for this? It's easy to come and say this. Everyone knows this. What is the proof? Your brother should know your proofs for your religion. Everyone should know the proofs for his religion. Why do I say what I say? Where do I find this belief? Bowing down to Adam, that's one proof. Okay, you can use that as a proof. Very good. That all of them bow down to Adam. Yeah, not really a proof against a fourth. Not really related. There's a clear verse in the Quran. لا يعصون الله ما أمرهم ويفعلون ما يؤمرون. This is in Surah Al-Tahrim, verse 6. They do not disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concerning what He has commanded them, and they do what they are ordered. Clear, explicit verse, no interpretation here. You know? They do not, or they cannot disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in what He has commanded them, and they do what they are commanded. They do what they have been ordered to do. Okay? Likewise, in another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَخَافُونَ رَبَّهُم مِّن فَوْقِهِمْ وَيَفْعَلُونَ مَا يُؤْمَرُونَ. Surah An-Nahl, verse 50. That they fear their Lord who is above them. Obviously, we see that the angel in the sky is obviously Allah is above them. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is nothing above Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they fear their Lord who is above them, meaning above the angels, and they do as they are commanded. They do as they are commanded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? Another point that is related to their worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in different manners or different ways. They have different characteristics or different manners through which or by which they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of them is at-tasbih, saying subhanallah all the time. Okay, we mentioned already some proofs for this. Who can remember one proof that we mentioned? Okay, good. Okay, the hadith of the skies, that there's not a single place. Okay, another one. They're always giving tasbih, and they never get tired of it. They never get tired of giving tasbih. Okay, so of them is that all of the angels, they continually praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They continually praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They continually worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by this tasbih. Okay, in Surah Safat, verse 166, Allah describes the angel as saying, وَإِنَّا لَنَحْنُ الْمُسَبِّحُونَ. We are the ones who give tasbih. We are the ones who always give tasbih to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also, they give tasbih by saying, Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi. In one hadith, the Prophet mentions that the best zikr, or the best remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is what the angels say. And that is, Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi. So we know that the angels, they praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by saying subhanallah wa bihamdihi continually, all the time. Another way that they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is prayer, sajda. We already mentioned the proof for this, one of the proofs for this, which is the hadith of the skies, is that there is not a single space of four fingers except that there is an angel either standing in prayer, or in ruku' or in sujood. So of the aspects of the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that they pray. What is another proof is the hadith of the rows, of the ranks, is that the Prophet said, do you not want to line up like the angels line up? In other words, they also line up in prayer. Okay? Yet another aspect of their worship is that they perform Hajj. We already mentioned the proof for this also. Baytul Ma'mur. The Baytul Ma'mur, okay? And this is a Kaaba that is meant for the angels. It is a similar type of structure for the angels, okay? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions Wal Baytul Ma'mur in the Quran. He swears by the Baytul Ma'mur. In verse 4 of what? Which surah? Surah 2? No. Tur. وَالطُورِ وَكِتَابٍ مَسْطُورِ فِي رَقِّ مَشُورِ وَالْبَيْتِ الْمَعْمُورِ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the fourth verse of Surah Al-Tur, He mentions this Bayt al-Ma'mur. Okay? Brothers, know your evidences. Write this stuff down. You should know this stuff. You should know. If someone asks you, where do you get this from? Don't say, my grandparents taught me this. It's not good enough. No, I'm not putting grandparents. I'm saying this is not good enough. You're intellectuals now. You're men now. You know, you're not little children. Know the evidences. Allah said this. His messenger said that. The Sahaba said this. This is what your religion is based upon. Okay? Everyone should know the evidences for his religion. It's very important. Likewise, the hadith of the 70,000 angels entering the Bayt al-Ma'mur every day. This was already mentioned. Another aspect or another way that they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that they are in continual fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They continually are humble for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And obviously the angels have reached the perfect state of worship in that they always worship Allah. They never tire of this worship. They never get bored of this worship. Physically, mentally, psychologically, they're always worshipping Allah. Their tongues are rich with tasbih. Their bodies are always praying. They go for hajj. And inside of them, their hearts are fearful for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the angels in the Quran, Surah Anbiya, verse 28, وَهُمْ مِنْ خَشْيَتِهِ مُشْفِقُونَ. And they are continually fearing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are ever fearing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, in one hadith, the Prophet ﷺ describes Jibreel, that Jibreel, he was like trembling, if you like, out of fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? So he was sitting at a certain place, out of his fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet ﷺ could see the fear that Jibreel had of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is their worship, the second chapter that we're going to do. And the third chapter which we're going to conclude with is their relationship with mankind. Okay? The relationship of the angels with mankind. Everyone knows that the angels, they asked the wisdom behind our creation. This is mentioned in Surah Baqarah. Which verse? 35, 36. Very good. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the creation of Adam, and that the angels, they questioned Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now this questioning was not a questioning of disobedience. Don't think that they were questioning out of disobedience, that how dare you create? No. They were questioning for a reason. Okay? That they were questioning, why are you doing this? Not as a disobedient act, but to increase their own knowledge. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them this knowledge. Like we said, they cannot get this by themselves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then gave them this knowledge that you do not know what I know. Right? You do not know what I know. Okay? And then they said, Subhanaka la ilma lana illa ma 'allamtana innaka antal 'alimul hakim. So one of the things is that the angels did is that they asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about the purpose of the creation of the of mankind. Another aspect, obviously, is that they all bowed down to Adam alayhi salam. Okay. Now Allah says in the Quran, فَسَجَدَ الْمَلَائِكَةُ كُلُّهُمْ أَجْمَعُونَ إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ. That all of the angels, all of them, فَسَجَدَ الْمَلَائِكَةُ, the angels, كُلُّهُمْ, all of them, أَجْمَعُونَ, again, all of them. In other words, two types of emphasis to the, I mean, this is something that you really cannot translate in the Arabic, into English, okay? Is that you have something in Arabic called at-tawqid, right? Which means to emphasize. And this chapter is one of the chapters of Arabic grammar. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَسَجَدَ الْمَلَائِكَةُ, the angels, they prostrated. كلهم, every single one of them. أجمعون, again, every single one of them. Okay, there was no exception. And then Allah said, إِلَّا إِبْلِيسِ, except for Iblis. So because of this verse, and there's two or three verses like this, some people presumed or thought that Iblis was amongst the angels. How do they get this from this verse? Because Allah says, all of them bowed down, and then He said, except. إِلَّا إِبْلِيس. How can we refute this? Well, firstly, is this true? Okay, Okay, how do we refute this then? Surat al-Kahf, okay. There's two ways to refute this. Firstly, what is the verse in Surat al-Kahf, Yaakhi? Khalas, you memorized the point that you need to know. Alhamdulillah, it's good enough, okay? You get the point. A B plus, huh? Good enough. وَكَانَ مِنَ الْجِنِّ Okay? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Iblis, right? Okay? كَانَ not what? It's كَانَ مِنَ الْجِنِّ فَفَسَقَ عَنْ أَمْنِ رَبِّهِ Okay? That the Iblis was of the jinn. So this verse is explicit. This verse is explicit. Surah Al-Kahf, that كَانَ مِنَ الْجِنِّ Iblis was of the jinn. فَفَسَقَ عَنْ أَمْنِ رَبِّهِ So he disobeyed the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? So this verse is explicit. Doesn't need any proof. The most explicit verse in the Quran mentions that Iblis was of the jinn. However, the question arises, how do you explain or how do you understand the first verse, which says that except, إِلَّا All of the angels except. And in general, when you use except, then it means like everyone in the class failed except for Ahmed. Which means Ahmed was a part of the class. You see what I'm saying? The word except in general is used to be that the person is still a part of the group. So how do you explain this first thing? The way you explain this first is that the angels and the jinns, they were together. Physically they were together. It doesn't mean that they were one group in the sense that suppose we have brothers and sisters in the same class. Like in our class we have sisters and then we have brothers here. Okay? So now, we are one group and yet we are two groups. We are two genders. Right? At the same time, we are one class. We are together. So if I were to say, all of the students failed except for Ahmed. Okay? Then it could have two meanings to it. Either all of the brothers failed, and I'm not talking about the sisters, right? Or I'm talking about both as a group. You see what I'm saying? So I can say, all of the students failed except for Fatima. In this case, I'm referring to brothers and sisters. Everyone failed except for this one. But so it depends on how you're looking at this word except. The angels and the jinns, they were together physically. But they weren't all the same type. There were angels and then there were jinns. Okay? You see where I'm coming from? Is that the word except in this case has been used as this group of creation, which comprised of angels and jinns. So of this group of creation, everyone did sajda, except for Iblis and the people that followed Iblis, which is the jinn that obeyed him. Okay? The point is, let's get back to the chapter topic. Of the aspects of the angels when it comes to mankind, is that they guard the pious believers. They guard the pious believers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Ra'd, verse 10, لَهُ مُعَقِّبَاتٌ مِنْ بَيْنِ يَدَيْهِ وَإِنْ خَلْفِهِ يَحْفَظُونَ مِنْ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ That he has protectors. He has مُعَقِّبَات. He has those things that are going to guard him. In front of him and behind him. They guard him with the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these angels, then they protect the pious amongst mankind. One of the jobs of the angels with regards to mankind. Yet another job, obviously, is that the angels are responsible for sending down, for revealing the wahi. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given this responsibility to the angel Jibreel, that he is the one that communicates with all of the prophets. What is the proof for this? Very good, the hadith in the Quran, that's the proof. Correct answer, but zero credit. Yes, the hadith of the Quran is the proof for this, but where? It doesn't refer to the angel Jibreel. It doesn't refer to the angel Jibreel. نَزَلَ بِهِ الرُّوحُ الْأَمِينَ The Holy Spirit came down. Also, the verse that you mentioned, Akhi, about Jibreel, is that Jibreel is the one who revealed this down. Another proof, though, is that when the Prophet Muhammad first received his first revelation, or received his first revelation exactly, who said that? Very good. That when Waraq ibn Nawfal heard what the Prophet Muhammad, what happened to the Prophet Muhammad, he said, this is the namus. What is the meaning of namus? The keeper of secrets. This is the keeper of secrets that came to Musa alayhi salam. When Waraq ibn Nawfal heard about the angel Jibreel and what he did to the Prophet ﷺ, or the incident that occurred, he said, this is the same keeper of secrets that came to Musa ﷺ. So this shows you then that Jibreel ﷺ is the one who is responsible for sending down or taking the revelation. The questions, inshallah, let's finish up quickly. Likewise, of the characteristics or of the responsibilities of the angel when it comes to the children of Adam is that they are responsible for recording the good and the evil deeds. Everyone knows this, that the angels are responsible for recording the good deeds and the evil deeds of mankind. What is the proof for this? مَا يَلْفِظُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيدٌ. Which surah is this in? Surah Qaf. That he does not say a single word except that he has a raqib and an atid. Raqib means he's ever watchful. Atid means he's ever prepared to write it down. Okay? So these are not the angels' names. They are the angels' description. The angels' name is not raqib and atid. No. It is the description of the angels. Is that they are ever watchful, ever present, and they're ever ready to write down. Okay? So the angels then, they are responsible for... Likewise, in another verse, Allah says, وَإِنَّ عَلَيْكُمْ لَحَافِظِينَ كِرَامًا كَاتِبِينَ. That they are guardians over you, not guarding you physically, but guarding you your deeds. In the sense, they record your deeds. كِرَامًا كَاتِبِينَ. They are noble writers. They write, كَاتِب. They're writing down. What are they writing down? Your good deeds. Okay? They're writing down your good deeds. Likewise, of the characteristics of the angels, is that they pray for the guidance of mankind, and they pray for the blessing of the people of good. Okay, where does it say this in the Quran? Who's يستغفرون للذين آمنوا? Okay, that they ask forgiveness for those who believe. Another verse. The verses of Surah Al-Ghafir. Where are they? Is that? If someone has the Quran, you can look at the second page of Surah Al-Ghafir on the top hand side if you look at it. I can't remember right now what they are. Yeah, وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ لِمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. That the angels, they ask forgiveness for those that are on this earth. The angels, they ask for the forgiveness of the inhabitants of the earth, meaning the pious inhabitants, okay? Likewise, they make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless the good doers. For example, Allah, the Prophet ﷺ said that not a single day goes by except that two angels come down. One of them says, "Oh Allah, bless the one who gives money with more, okay? And give the one who is miserly less." In other words, restrict upon the one who is miserly. So the point is that the angels, they make a dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless the one who does good, and they make a dua against the one who does evil or the one who is miserly, okay? Likewise, the angels, they take charge of giving the believer good tidings or evil tidings at his death. Is that when a person dies, immediately, either the good angels are going to come to him, or the angels that are responsible for showing him punishment. Okay, we're not going to say bad angels. There's no such thing as bad angels. All angels are good. Okay, all angels are respected. But you have those angels that are responsible for showing mankind mercy and showing them good, and you have other angels that are responsible for punishing them. So right when a person dies, the angels, the responsible, whatever angels, the angels that are responsible for showing good, or the angels that are responsible for punishment, they are going to come to mankind and either give him that good or give him the punishment. And this is proven in a number of verses of the Quran and also a number of ahadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Likewise, of the things that the angels are responsible, or of the characteristics of the angel when it comes to the believers, is that they love all of the angels, they love all of the pious servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The angels, they love the believers. The angels, they love the believers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he loves a person, he calls out to Jibreel. He says that, "Jibreel, I love so and so, so love him." So Jibreel then calls out to the other angels, and he says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves so and so, so you also love him. So all of the people of the heavens, they then love this person, and then he is accepted amongst people. In other words, the love of this person is then given amongst all of people. And by the way, this hadith, I heard that Shaykh Abdul Muhsin Abbad, one of the scholars of our times, he said that inshaAllah, he hopes that this hadith applies to Shaykh Abdul Aziz ibn Abdullah ibn Baz. Is that you find that some strange thing is that very few people have been blessed with such a type of love that Shaykh ibn Baz was blessed with. You know, that everyone, those that know him and those that didn't know him, you know, those that met him and those that didn't meet him, even many, many of the people that didn't like him, still they couldn't find hatred for him in their hearts, you know. They had love for him in their hearts, okay? So, inshallah, Shaykh Abdul Aziz said, inshallah, we don't know this for sure, but inshallah, he hopes and he prays that that Shaykh Abdul Aziz ibn Abdullah ibn Baz was one of those that applied, that this hadith applies to. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he told the angels that, "I love so and so, so love him." And because of this, the people of the skies, they loved him. And because of this, acceptance was written for this person on the face of this earth. And we don't say this of a surety, we don't know this. is of the ilm al-ghayb, but we pray and we hope, inshaAllah, that this was of the people that this hadith applies to. There are many other aspects regarding the angels which we can talk about, but inshaAllah, this book, which is one of the most comprehensive books about the angels, will be translated soon if it hasn't already been translated, and it should be available in English language, published in Saudi Arabia. So inshallah, I encourage all of you to buy it. My topic was pretty much based on this. I only added a few points from my head. The rest of it was based on this book. If there are any questions with regards to the angels, we will answer them to the best of our ability. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
Okay, inshallah, we'll start the question and answer.
Okay, I'll tell you. Go ahead.
The first question is, because of the fact that Jibreel is Aruh Alameen, does that mean that angels and spirits are the same thing?
The word Ruh has a number of meanings to it. It can apply to a number of different aspects, a number of different meanings. The spirit that is in a person's body can also be called Ruh, okay? But also the angels can also be called Ruh. So it depends. It's a word that can have a number of different meanings depending on the context. But angels and spirits are not the same thing. Well, firstly, I have to ask, what does the brother or the sister mean by spirits? In the English language, when he says the word spirits, okay? Does he mean the soul that a person has? In this case, then of course no. The angels are different, and the souls are different. Every living object has been blessed with a soul. Even the jinns, they have a soul to them. Mankind, they have a soul to them. Animals, they have a soul to it, okay? So when you kill the animal, the soul is taken away. When you kill a human being, or when a human being dies, the soul is taken away. Okay? So the soul is different from the angel. An angel is different from the soul. So what do you mean by spirit? If you mean the soul, then of course no. But the Arabic word ruh, I'm saying, it applies to different things depending on the context. The Arabic word ruh could apply to the angels. Like for example in this verse, ar-ruh al-ameen, the Holy Spirit. Okay? Or it could also apply to the ruh or the soul that is inside a person's body. Okay? So it depends on how a person uses it and in which context it is used, but no, they are not the same thing, definitely. They are not the same thing. No.
Could you explain the hadith concerning Musa and Angel of Death?
The scholars have different interpretations to this hadith. Basically, what happened was that... let me see if this author has any more detail than that. But basically, what happened was that when the Angel of Death, he came to take the soul of Musa, okay, then Musa alayhi salam, perhaps he did not believe that this was the angel of death, or perhaps yani, he did not realize this. He basically punched the angel and gave him a black eye. Literally, gave him a black eye. This is exactly what the hadith says. So, Musa, or the angel of death, went back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he says that, and the angel of death said, "Oh Allah, you have sent me to a person who does not want to die, because he gave me a black eye." He punched him in the eye and the angel of death went away, you know, back up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then returned him to his eye, and then returned his eye to him, excuse me, and then said to him, "Go to Musa, go to my servant and say, do you wish to have life? If you wish to have life, then rub your hand on the back of this animal. And for every hair that your hand touches, you will be living for 1 year." So you'll be touching a few hundred hairs at least when you go over the back of an animal. So for every hair that you touch, you will be given 1 year to live. Okay? So then, when the angel of death told this to Musa, Musa asked, "Then what?" Angel of death said, "After that will be mort. After that will be death. No one can live forever." Okay? So then, in that case, Musa said, "In that case, I'll die now. In that case, I will die now." So then Allah, the angel of death then took his soul. But the point is that, really, the interpretation of this hadith, the scholars have differed about it, but the point is that perhaps, and Allah knows best, perhaps Musa did not realize that this was the angel of death, you know? You have any other response for this? Oh, okay, excellent. Okay, so he didn't recognize the angel of death, basically. Do you have any idea where this narration is? Because I've never heard of this narration. Those weird names, though. Okay, so basically the scholars say that Musa did not recognize that this was the angel of death, therefore he punched him and gave him a black eye, and Musa, as you know, was, mashallah, a very strong person. You know the incident where he whipped the stone, and the stone was left with 7-8 markings, and Abu Hurairah said that if you wish I could tell you where it is, and the markings are still there to this day. where he whipped the stone so hard that he hit the stone so hard that those markings are still present on that stone. You know. So, inshallah, let's move to the next question. I think I answered that question, inshallah.
I did not understand when you said, whoever is an enemy to the angels. What do you mean by this? How could one possibly be an enemy to the angels?
This is a question that you should ask the Jews. This is a question that you should go ask the Jews. How can you possibly hate the angels? Okay? Because the verse was revealed with regards to the Jews. Is that the Jews, until this day, they hate the angel Jibreel. Okay? They hate the angel Jibreel. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, whoever is an enemy to Jibreel, he's an enemy to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you hate Allah and His messengers, and His books, and His angels, and you disbelieve in any aspect of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, that it is as if you have disbelieved in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? So this verse was revealed to refute the Jews. Is that whoever is an enemy to Jibreel, then know that Jibreel is the one who has revealed this Quran to you. Jibreel is the one that is the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You cannot be an enemy to Jibreel except if you're an enemy to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this question should be addressed to the Jews, is that how can you hate the angel Jibreel? And the reason that they hated the angel Jibreel is mentioned in Sahih Bukhari. This is their superstitions, their stupidity, whatever you want to call it, that they felt that the angel Jibreel was the angel of war. That whenever a war would occur, then they would, then the angel Jibreel would come down to help the believers, right? So they felt an evil forebodingness, if you like, an evil premonition, that whenever Jibreel comes down, it means death, okay? Because that means war, it means fighting. Whereas in fact, it is the exact opposite. Jibreel comes down to bring the life of the heart, and Jibreel comes down to defend the believers against their enemies. But the Jews, they really don't have an intellect. That's why, you know, you should ask them this question. Now,
after Qiyamah, will angels continue to live? What purpose will they serve?
This is concerning the ilm al-ghayb. For sure, we do know that some of the angels will live after the Qiyamah. This is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ يَدْخُلُونَ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنْ كُلِّ بَابٍ سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ بِمَا صَبَرْتُمْ فَنِعْمَ عُقُبَ الدَّارِ. That the angels, basically the angels will be helping the believers and will be, you know, giving glad tidings to believers in Jannah. After the Day of Judgment, in Jannah. That the angels will give glad tidings to believers, they are going to help the believers in Jannah. So they're going to serve the believers. So this shows you then that the angels will exist after the Day of Judgment. What they will do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, the rest of them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, this of the knowledge of the unseen. Yes. Yes, of course, good point. Jazakallah khair. Obviously, the angels are also going to be punishing the disbelievers, the exact opposite. So they will exist after the Day of Judgment. Also, a sister asked, when you say angels love pious believers, does that mean they have feelings? Yes. Yes, whatever feelings Allah has given them, we affirm them for the angels. You think it's strange that angels have feelings? The Prophet ﷺ said that the mountain of Uhud, the mountain, it's a mountain outside of Medina. The mountain of Uhud is a mountain that loves us, and we love it. So every believer, when he passes by Uhud, and even if he doesn't pass by Uhud, he should realize and know that this mountain loves him, and in his heart he should have a love for this mountain. This is an authentic hadith in Sahih Bukhari, that the mountain of Uhud, and it's a mountain, you look at it, it looks like every other mountain, you know, I mean, it doesn't, you don't see a crown on top of it or a light shine. No, it's a normal mountain. But in our hearts we believe that this mountain is a mountain that loves us, and in return we love this mountain too. So it's not strange that the angels have feelings, even other things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is capable of all things. This is an important question, I would like to answer it also. Okay, wait, a second question that this asks. A very good question, actually. A very good question. Okay, where else is proof that the angel Jibreel was the revealing angel? Can a non-Muslim's Waraqah's testimony be used as evidence? Firstly, Waraqah ibn Nawfal was one of the first Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He died as a believer. In one hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Verily, I saw Waraqah swimming in one of the streams of paradise." Okay, Waraqah ibn Nawfal, he accepted the Prophethood of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in fact, he wished that he was younger. He said, "Ya laytani kuntu jada'a." I wish I was a young, strong man that I could defend you when your people are going to kick you out of your city. So the Prophet said, "Awa mukhrijiyahum?" Are they indeed going to kick me out? Are they indeed going to expel me? And Waraqah said, "Yes. For by Allah, no one has come with what you have been come, except that he is persecuted by his people." So Waraqah wished that he was a young man. He wished that he was a young person that could defend the Prophet's life. Look at the love and look at the eagerness he had for the Prophet ﷺ. And yet, unfortunately, or Allah's will, we shouldn't say unfortunately, he died very soon after this incident. So the point is that he died a believer, he was not a non-Muslim. Secondly, as we know, one of the aspects of the Sunnah is composed of three aspects. The first one is the Prophet's actions. The second one is the Prophet's statements. And the third one is the Prophet's approval of other actions or statements. So the very fact... No, that doesn't come under this category of Sunnah. We will talk about this next 2 weeks, inshallah. The very fact that Waraqah made the statement and it was not corrected, either by the Prophet or by inspiration, shows that it is correct. Okay? Also, we are not in need of Waraqah's statement. We have other evidences in the Quran and Sunnah. For example, the hadith of Rabba Jibreel wa Mika'il wa Israfil. This is an implicit evidence that the scholars have derived that Jibreel is the one that brings down inspiration to all the prophets. Okay? Also, which verse am I referring to? Let me think now. Which verse is it? Basically, there are other verses in the Quran that show that the angel Jibreel is the one that is the one that is in charge of revealing the revelation. The last question that is on this card, and it is not relevant to the topic, but it is also very important. Does Allah physically come down to the last third of the night? How do you explain it since there is a third of the night all the time somewhere in the world? This is an extremely long topic, an extremely important topic. Basically, it deals with the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we should realize that the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we will never be able to understand the actuality of the name and attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We can't understand the howness. We can't understand it. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above us. Let me ask you, can anyone explain to me how angel Jibreel has 600 wings? Can you understand this in your head, 600 wings? Can you envision it? No. Can you envision how the mountain of Uhud loves us? No. If you cannot understand the creation, how can you understand the Creator? If you cannot understand how the mountain of Uhud loves us, and yet we must believe that the mountain of Uhud loves us, then how can we understand the Creator of the mountain of Uhud? Okay? So, we affirm whatever Allah has said. I didn't say that Allah comes down the last third of the night. The Prophet ﷺ said it. In over 25 narrations, this hadith is mutawatir. This hadith has been narrated. It's in Bukhari and Muslim, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Nisa'i, Muwatta, Imam Ahmad. Every book of hadith you find this hadith mentioned in it. It is one of the most profusely narrated, and one of the most common hadith. Over 25 sahaba narrated this hadith. So it's from the Sahaba generation, 25 people, underneath them, make it exponential. Underneath them, even more. You find literally hundreds of narrations, hundreds of chains of narrations for this hadith. So it's not just a hadith, even if it were, we would have to accept it, but it is mutawatir. It is narrated by many, many, many Sahaba and Tabi'in. So I'm not the one that said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes down the last of the night, it is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And because the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said it, we accept it, and we believe in it. We don't ask how, we don't ask... You know, we believe in it. We are simple believers. We سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. We hear and we obey. We don't become like the Greeks or the Romans that we start thinking and pondering over the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No. If Allah says He is Ar-Rahman, we accept Allah is Ar-Rahman. If Allah says He is Ar-Rahim, we accept Allah is Ar-Rahim. We understand what Rahman and Rahim are, but we will never be able to understand how Allah is Rahman and Rahim, or the extentness or the vastness of Allah's Rahmah. We will never be able to understand it. Likewise, if Allah has said that He comes down the last third of the night, we accept it. We don't think or ponder about how or why. This is beyond our comprehension. Okay? And as for this point that there is a last third of the night everywhere, yes, there is a last third of the night somewhere on the face of this earth, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that portion or at that place where there is a last third of the night, He will be there. How, we don't know. It is not our job. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not made it obligatory upon us to know this. Had He made it obligatory upon us, He would have told us. But He didn't tell us. What He did tell us was that He does come down the last third of the night. Okay? So wherever we are, if we're in Houston, Texas, then we should realize that the last third of the night is a very barakah, is a very mubarak time. It is a very blessed time. That we should, if we want to make a special dua, we should make it during this time. And we should offer tahajjud and pray Quran at this time. And know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is close to us at this time. As for getting philosophical, in Dallas and in California, it's going to be a different time. We don't think about this. We leave. This is the ilm al-ghayb. That الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. This is the whole point of believing. They believe in the unseen. We cannot understand the creation. How can we understand Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And realize, Allah is the creator of time and space. Allah has created time. Can we understand time? We can't even understand time. The clock keeps on ticking. It's never going to come back. Allah is the one that created time. And He is the one that created space. Is not Allah the creator of time and space? Is not Allah capable of being free of the limitations of time and space? Allah is the one that created time and space. Is not Allah capable of being free of the limitations of time and space? Now these Ash'aris and these people that have philosophy in their brains are going to come to you and they're going to bring these shubuhat or these doubts. Is that how can Allah be above us? If He's above us, it means that there is something that is above. In other words, they're going to come to you with logic. Okay? If you say that Allah is above us, that means that there is something above Him and there's something above Him. How can this be? You say, A'udhu Billah. I didn't say Allah is above us. I didn't say this. The Quran says this in over 1,000 verses. Over 1,000 verses in the Quran that implicitly or explicitly mention that Allah is above us. Like we said in this verse, يَخَافُونَ رَبَّهُمْ مِنْ فَوْقِهِمْ. If anyone understands Arabic, he realizes the angels, they fear Allah, مِنْ فَوْقِهِمْ, above them. وَيَفْعَلُونَ مَا يُؤْمَرُونَ. Likewise, the Prophet ﷺ himself said, like Brother Hood quoted in his lecture before mine, that he said that the highest thing or the highest creation is Jannatul Firdaus. And on top of Jannatul Firdaus is the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And on top of the throne is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we don't now think that our limited minds that measure 5 centimeters by 5 centimeters are going to be able to encompass and understand the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We can't do this. Upon us is to accept and to believe. Okay? So the sister's question, jazahallahu khair, it's a good question, but I advise her, don't think about this. Okay? Don't ponder over these things. Believe it and accept it. Yes, brother, you have a... Yeah, you don't imagine this. You cannot imagine. You can't imagine Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't imagine. You believe that He's coming down because He told you He's coming down. But you don't let your mind think about how or what are the characteristics, anything. No. You leave it to the ilm al-ghayb. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not everywhere in His essence. He is everywhere in His knowledge. Allah is not everywhere in His essence. Many people, they say Allah is everywhere, but they have to understand what do they mean when they say Allah is everywhere. Allah is not physically everywhere. He is everywhere in His knowledge. No one should say Allah is everywhere and put a full stop there. No. Obviously, everyone knows this. I mean, everyone knows Allah, a'udhu billah, Allah is not in the bathroom. Allah is not inside our stomachs. No, really. People should understand when they say Allah is everywhere, they don't understand. They should add a phrase, Allah is everywhere in His knowledge. No one really believes Allah is everywhere physically. We're not walking through Allah. Everyone knows this. This is the fitrah. We know we're not walking through Allah. We're not swimming through Allah. Astaghfirullah. No. We should think about this. Allah is everywhere in His knowledge. By His knowledge. Okay? Physically, He is above us. Yani His that or His essence is above us. He is everywhere in His knowledge. Okay? No, even the smallest child, yani he realizes Allah is not everywhere. If you say Allah is everywhere, he'll say, where? I don't see Him. Where? He's not everywhere in this sense. Okay?
But the angels are everywhere.
The angels are physically everywhere, yeah. As for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then He is above us. And He is always above us. He never becomes a part of His creation, and His creation never become a part of Him. He is distinct and separate from the creation. Okay? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if this were the case, like Imam Ahmad said, if this were the case, then He would be inside the womb of Mary. And He would be, you know, inside the places of restroom. Imam Ahmad said this to the Jahmiya, because this was the belief of the Jahmiya, one of the heretical groups that was outside the fold of Islam. They said Allah is everywhere. So he told them, if you say that Allah is everywhere, this means He's inside the womb of Mary. When Isa was born, he's trying to imply He can be in even the most dirty of places, that inside the restroom, inside your stomachs, everywhere. No one truly believes that Allah is everywhere. No Muslim truly believes Allah is everywhere. So when you say, brother, Allah is everywhere, you should add the statement, by His knowledge. As for His essence, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above us. Okay? Can mankind become angels when accepted to paradise? No, mankind will never become angels. Mankind is always going to remain mankind. Okay? The angels are going to help or serve mankind, but mankind is going to always remain in his state of being man. Do angels perform hajj in Mecca in human form during the hajj season? Not that I know of. I mean, Allahu a'lam. Do angels perform hajj in Mecca in human form? Allahu a'lam. I mean, this is not something that is narrated in the Quran and Sunnah. So if anyone says that they do, let them bring forth their proof, you know. The Bayt al-Ma'mur, this is a similar question. Is the location of Bayt al-Ma'mur known or specified in the Quran and Sunnah? Some narrations say that it is above the Kaaba. Okay? Some narrations, some hadith, they say that it is above the Kaaba. So Allahu a'lam where, and it is above the seventh heavens, or in the seventh heavens, excuse me. In the seventh heavens, above the Kaaba. Okay? Huh? The narration of Ibn Abbas. No, that's Bayt al-Izzah. That's not Bayt al-Ma'mur. Bayt al-Izzah. Okay. A friend once told me that every person has a jinn which stays with him and tells him what to do. Is there really a jinn, or is he just talking about our self-consciousness? He also said that the Prophet ﷺ converted his jinn to Islam. This is true. Every single person has also been assigned an evil jinn that tries to whisper to him or misguide him from the truth. And the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ converted his jinn to Islam, so his jinn only commanded him to do good. As for all of us, then he has to combat and battle this jinn that is with him. Is it good to have the name Michael, or is the name Mikael better? Neither of the two names is recommended to have, because the names of the angels are, in general, they should not be kept by mankind. Shaykh Uthaymeen has a fatwa on this, that it is better, I'm not saying it's haram, it is better not to name your children by the names of the angels. Okay. Especially like Michael, this is a Christian name. I mean, we should, even if we wanted to do it, I mean, you know, we should have the Islamic Mika'il is not Michael. Mika'il is different from Michael. It sounds similar and it's based on the root, but it is different. But Shaykh Uthaymeen and the other ulama, they have given a fatwa that that it is not recommended. They didn't say it's haram, they said it is not recommended to give your children angels' names. How did the angels know that Adam will be on earth? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنِّي جَاعِنُ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. I'm going to place on this earth a progeny that will come one after the other. So the angels knew it because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him that. It is said that when Quraysh died, this is how the questioner asked it, the angels tried to stuff things in his mouth so that he may not be able to ask God's forgiveness at his death. Is that true? And does that happen as a fact amongst angels? The brother or the sister is confused. What is he or he referring to? Fir'aun. Okay, there was no such person by the name of Quraysh, by the way. There was no such. There was no human being that was called Quraysh. It was a title. It wasn't his name. There's a hadith in which Angel Jibreel told the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He said, "I wish that you could have seen how I was stuffing sand into Fir'aun's mouth." Okay? Out of fear that he might, you know, ask Allah's forgiveness at this time. Out of fear that he might, you know, accept Islam at this time. And obviously, Angel Jibreel was doing this at the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because he cannot do anything except what Allah commands him to do. Okay? But the point is that Fir'aun, there was no tyrant in human history that was worse than him. No one oppressed his people. And no one did more harm and more zulm and more fasad than Fir'aun did. Okay? So, and he was, and there was no one that was more. He said, Fir'aun said, I am your Lord, I am God, worship me. أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى. I am your Lord. You know? So even if Angel Jibreel did this, we should thank the Angel Jibreel. We should thank the Angel Jibreel that this, and by the way, Fir'aun, he was not going to accept Islam. He was not going to. He clearly knew, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Musa in the Quran as saying, لَقَدْ عَلِمْتَ أَنَّهُ لَا but the surah, that's one verse, and there's also one surah Isra, the last verse of surah Isra. Is that you know, that's one verse, brother, who quoted, is that you know of a fact that what has come to me is a revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Fir'aun knew that Musa was a prophet. Of course he knows he's not God. He knows he's not God. Any human being that claims he's a God or he's a prophet, he knows he's a liar in his heart. Okay? Or he's a madman, one of the two. He's literally a madman, a lunatic. Or he knows he's a liar. So Fir'aun knew that he was a liar. And Fir'aun knew that Musa was a true messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he was shown sign after sign after sign. How many signs was he shown? How many miracles was he shown? Nine clear, open miracles he was shown. And he kept on rejecting over and over and over and over again. So therefore, when the Nile parted, and he entered into the Nile, and the Nile started coming back on him, at this point when he saw his death, not because he saw the miracle, he realized, this is from Allah. When he realized he was going to die, when he realized, this is it, now I'm going to go to Jahannam, that's when he says, La ilaha illa ant. Not even that, he said, there is no God except the God of the children of Israel. He didn't even say, La ilaha illallah. He said, there is no God except the God of the children of Israel. Okay? And I am of the believers. And Allah tells him, Al-an, now, now of all times, after you have rejected so many times, nine times, over and over again, and you knew in your heart that Musa is the prophet, you rejected him, now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to accept it from me. So even if Jibreel was doing this, firstly, a person at his death, his repentance is not accepted, okay? This is only meant to make the punishment worse upon him. Only meant to humiliate him more. That sand is being stuffed in his mouth, being thrown in his mouth. It is meant to humiliate him even at his death. Secondly, Jibreel must have done this at the command of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay? Excuse me. At the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, any more questions from the brothers? It is the Nile. And need.
That was the Red Sea.
Hmm?
We switched to the Red Sea.
It is the Red Sea. It is the Red Sea. It's getting late in the day. This happens after. It is, huh? Big trouble. Any other questions or we conclude inshallah? Yes. Oh, you're ready for King's Chicken? طيب وذلك إن شاء الله سبحانك اللهم بحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت استغفرك وأتوب إليك